If you don't have the faith of a child yourself, there's no way that you can enter in. So we gotta have childlike faith. Let's teach them faith. Let's teach them about their Lord and Savior. Glory to God. God bless you. We want to turn it over to Pastor Hill this time. Let's say amen.
I want to say to the children workers, hold on just a second, all of the children's workers, we really want to just put emphasis on this, that it's important for children workers to be in church as much as possible, and we need, y'all, we really need to try to get it outlined where it won't be the same ones out every week, because if you are out on Sunday and you're not here during the week at all, that's a failed disaster. I mean, you might not realize that what detriment you're causing. That's very serious. So we just want y'all to work that out and not the same one as the holiday Sunday. Okay. And if you're out on Sunday more than you want to be, there are a lot of sessions during the week that we try to cover just about everything that we're doing on Sunday and Wednesday nights. That's really, really, I'm telling you, that's really, really important. Amen. That for you to get what you need so that you can have in you what you need to give to others. Okay. Okay, I just want to, before I get started today, I want to see how many maybe two or three would like to testify as to something specific that the Lord has done in your life, especially if in the area of soul winning. I know that some of you have been really reaching out to loved ones, to friends and acquaintances, and we really appreciate the focus that you have placed on the importance of soul winning. We just want to keep that in mind. Different ones last week were very instrumental in bringing several. And today we have also those that have really brought, I know several brought several with them as they were coming in the door. I just saw all of them. The loved ones that they brought with them. So we just want to thank God for those that really focus and, you know, and really adhere to the admonition that we are given concerning the importance of reaching out. All right, so is there anyone that want to? Okay. Okay. It's kind of warm up here. Okay. Okay, we have Brother Chickwell. Thank God for him this morning. Amen.
Thank you, Pastor. Give an honor to God. You know, I was talking to God and I said, I'm so isolated where I work. And I work a lot. Not working, I'm here. So it's hard for me to reach out. That's not a problem for God. The wife called me and said, at work, and said she wasn't feeling well, would I stop by and pick up some fish? So I was on my way to Captain B's on Admiral, and God put this brother in front of me. And we've been riding back and forth to work together ever since then. And you know, the blessing is mine. The blessing is mine. Anything that God places in my life is always a blessing. And I just hope that he receives the same kind of blessing that I've received from him.
Good morning, church. I come to you as a visitor, but I'm already home.
All right.
God has moved so much in my life here in Tulsa, Oklahoma in the last 2 years, it's really overjoying, because this brother here, like he said, last Friday I was walking the street and just, you know, hey, praising God, doing what I have to do. I wasn't worried about it. He showed up, and unlike other people that I've run into here in Tulsa, most of the time when somebody's going to do something for you, the first thing out of their mouth is, do you have any money? He not once asked me anything about money. His wife reached out to me, their family, you know, I respect them as mom and dad, whether I told them that or not. Because under grace, God moves miracles.
Amen.
Just yesterday, to show you what I'm talking about, I needed to do laundry. Didn't have any money in my pocket. Didn't really have anywhere to go. God, I prayed to him all week, Father, if you can make any way possible for me to get this done. Two people. He lined up two people.
Glory to God.
I called one. He called me.
Yes.
The other one came in and said, look, I'll take care of the laundry. By the time he called me, I said, look, it's already done.
Praise God.
If you don't do anything else, you believe in God.
Amen.
And I'm going to tell you one other thing that I'm going to share with the minister here. God has been calling me for a while. I serve at home. Anything that happens in the church, I'm pretty much there. I sung in the choir, usher board. You know, if mom needed me to help her clean the church, I was there. He's called me to be a minister in the Word. So you guys pray for me, please. Because there's a battle going on out there. We are in our last days. Christ is on his way back. And I pray that those that do not know hell is real, believe me, it is.
Amen. Isn't that good?
Amen.
Bible says, more joy in heaven over one soul that comes to the Lord than 99 that don't believe in repentance. That's wonderful. I'm going to tell you, this is the heart of your faith, your walk with the Lord. It's the heart of Christianity. Being concerned, very concerned about those around you. Those in the church, those outside of the church, and those that need to be established in the church. Okay, Sister Angela, could you come? Amen. Just give us a report on those that you brought today. Okay. I was really blessed. You know, she always impressed me as a go-getter. I mean, as a mover and a shaker. And I believe I got it right. Come on down. And she was kind of tough to get into this. And I believe it's going to be tough to talk her out of it. All right, come on, Sister Angela. I'm just kind of shocked already about all this has been happening to you anyway. All right.
I know it is. I can't see.
Come everything, but I know that I'm being directed in the right path.
Yes.
So I just got to hold on.
Yes.
And next weekend I have another slumber party, a 9-year-old bunch. So I'm just gonna have so much fun. Yes. I'm here at this point of the year, but it has that. And the last one was right there, boom, 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 and he'll be 22.
Wow. So,
alright, that is good. Alright, make sure you check the parents out. I know you will. I mean, both ways, spiritually as well as otherwise. Alright, is that Sister Kenny you want to share? Amen. We'll give you a Sunday where you will give you a lot of time real soon. Let me know. But you can just come now and share what's on your heart. Brother Mariko, you can do the same. And some of these here probably are wondering if God can bless you in the area of your marriage, spiritually, financially. Amen. And that, a lot of different areas the Lord is blessing. So we just want to kind of hear from a wide range of experiences so that everybody know that God can meet all of our need according to his riches in glory through Christ. Amen. Amen.
Praise God. I'm a little bit surprised here, but I just want to thank God for all that he is doing. And just in the spirit of what we've been talking about in evangelism, things, realize the importance of it. I remember just about this time, 35 years ago, when I walked into this building, and I had an aunt that had come, and she said, "You got to hear the word that's over there." And so she first of all, she encouraged my mother to come. And my mother came, and she got excited, and she told my brother, and my brother got saved. And my brother got excited, and he told me, and I got saved. And we talked to different members of the family, and I had one sister that's kind of intellectual. And she wasn't so sure about that, but since I was supposed to be smart too, she says, "Well, if Candy will do it, I guess I'll go check it out." And she got saved. And then I had a sister that was just kind of hard. She just figured, "Well, Candy's good at two shoes. It's just easy for her, but God can't do nothing for me." But when she saw what God had done in Daniel's life, she said, "If God can save him, I'll go come check this out too." And she got saved. And you know, that my whole family got saved, and it took 30-something years later, but my father saw the difference in our lives, and it opened the door for him to get saved. Praise God. And so you never know what you're doing, and it's amazing too, and the person that really told me about it, they've kind of fallen out of the way there, and I'm praying for that person there, because I want her to get the crown for so many lives that she has affected. Praise God. But you know what? I got to thinking about what's the difference there, because all the rest of us, we stayed. We've been saved 35 years plus. Praise God. But you know, we came in, and that was the thing that my mother and my aunt were so impressed with, the word here. And we got into Bible study and started studying, and we were willing to learn and be taught the word. And so when life came to beat us up, we had the word in us, whereas the person that fell away, they decided, well, they didn't need nobody to tell them.
Oh.
Praise God. You know, you think that, well, maybe they'll kind of get it, okay, but they didn't need anybody to tell them. They'll go their own way. Well, life brings things. There's been a lot of things that's happened in the last 35 years. But when those things came, we had the word in us. And I want to encourage you, especially if you're, you know, some people come and say, "Well, I can't get into the word like y'all do. You know, I read the word and I'm not getting it." I want you to understand that even if you're not getting it, you're getting it.
That's right.
You know, that was me. I actually fretted the first few years I was saved, because I'm reading this and Danielle is coming on and just looking at it and says, "Oh, that's..." And let's pass the deal with Danielle, explain it to me. I didn't get it. Praise God. But I was blessed enough that I had a pastor and a husband that encouraged me, not only taught me the word, But they also taught me to dig into it and get into it myself. And so when those hard times in life came up, the word just rose up, praise God. And the devil tried, but the devil just couldn't prevail because the word prevails. Praise God, because where there is light, the word giveth light, and where there's light, there is no darkness at all. And so I just want to thank God and encourage you, not only to share with other people. And the other thing that I do want to realize, let you know is I told you that I wasn't getting it. You want to know when I finally started to get it? I lost my job, and I thought, you know what, devil, I'm going to make you mad, and I'm going to get busy. So I called Pastor Hill and said, give me somebody to work with. And it's amazing when I started studying to share with other people how the word opened up for me and became alive. And so I want to encourage you to share with other people. Praise God. And not to think that you're just insignificant, that it's just for the heavyweights to do it. Your life is a witness. Amen. Praise God. And God can use you if you avail yourself.
Amen.
All right. Okay, come on, Brother Mariko. No, brothers, the second Sunday, we're going to have brothers. They're going to be doing a service just like the women on the fifth Sunday, on the second Sunday. So you're going to hear from those that you haven't heard from. You're going to hear from them on the second Sunday. Okay, here's Brother Mariko. Now, he used to not talk before people like this. Now it's kind of hard. You got so much to say. It's kind of hard. Hallelujah. For him to get it all in.
Good morning, everybody.
Good morning.
I was caught off guard a little bit this morning. I guess I'm just going to share. I know this guy that works for me. And strong brother. He's an inspiration to me. He's, you know, he had heart surgery. He had other little physical things that's going on with him, but he never complained. He always giving God glory and praise, and he always thankful, you know. He goes the extra mile, you know, and that right there inspires me, because through his physical problems, he don't never complain. You'll never know he had a physical problem, you know. He's always sowing. I mean, literally. If he have a dime, last week, you know, he couldn't give to his, a couple of weeks ago, he couldn't give to his niece who graduated from nursing school. He didn't have any money, so he had a coupon, and he sold that to her life. And it may sound small, but he's always sowing, always. I mean, I don't care what it is. If that's all he got, he's going to get it, you know. And that hits me hard. I'm like, man. And I literally see God working this guy's life.
Praise God.
He can be down to his last, and all of a sudden, man, God bless me with this, and I came up with $75 of this and this and that. And I was like, man, you know, and I'm always telling him that God is always looking out for you, man, you and your family. And he's the only one working in this household right now. But he's always, things always get taken care of. You know, every chance I get, I always throw money his way, you know, extra work or, actually, a lot of times I do it, you know, just to help him out. He's just an inspiration to me. What I'm trying to say is it's important to just sow, you know. Sow, pay tithes. Man, that's huge, you know. Can't no stock market bless you like God can. You know? I know of someone, you know, I don't give no names, but I know of a couple of people, know them very well, very well. Bought, I'm just going to say a business, and they gave $15,000, and that $15,000 turned to a $500,000. That's how power, and these people are sowers. They tithe bills, they come from nothing, you know, and I seen God work in these two people's lives. I keep in mind, I know them very well. I can say this because I really know them very well. My in-laws know who I'm talking about. But when I see stuff like that, that lets me know God is very, very much so real. You take $15,000 and it produces over $500,000 in income, that can't be nothing but God. So I just want to encourage everybody to continue to sow, give, sacrifice, you know. That's the key. And a lot of people don't understand that. Salvation, I always hear my grandfather say, sacrifice, sacrifice, sacrifice. Didn't understand that at 15, 16, 17 years old. But when I got in my 20s, I really started registering, you know, I'm like, that's what they mean by sacrifice. Now, you got to go for broke, you know, and you got to really believe that God's got my back, you know, regardless. I'm getting my last, and no doubt, no shadow of doubt, my faith is so connected and strong, He's going to bless me with this. Because I'm a giver, I'm a sower, you know, I try to do right by folks. Try to be as honest as I can, you know. But that's very important to sowing. I don't know why I always, you know, that, I guess that's probably my ministry because God has really blessed me. You know, I come from my mother, father, grandparents did the best they could do. I owe the rest to God and I owe the rest to my wife because she stuck with me, helped me, you know, carry on my vision. God has given me the favor. But my wife has given me that support. And if a man got those two things, he can go anywhere. You know? So all those two things to God and my wife, and all to myself, because I wear my my head on my shoulder. You know, I try to be careful for people. And sometimes, you know, my wife put a heart on me because she's the. I'm the lenient one. She's the kind of the more, she's very frugal. But she's the, what word can I use? She's the tough one. I'm tough, now don't get me wrong now. You know, I can be tough and I want to be tough. You know, it ain't what I'm talking about. But she's the one that's, I would fire him. Be me, I'm like, let's wait. You know, so. That balance between her has is awesome because, you know, we balance each other out. You know? I need that backbone from her. She needs my backbone. And with those two ingredients, you have a team, you know. So I'm just thankful for everything. And I try to stay humble. And, you know, I don't say much because I just sit back and observe everything, you know. Hold it all in, but that's why, you know, I got another 30 minutes of talking to you right quick. So no, I'm just playing. But anyway, I just want to encourage everybody to keep doing what you have to do right, and sow and give and stay humble. Keep attitude in check, because your attitude affects your earning potential. Amen.
So, amen. All right. We just thank God for Rico. And I know that great testimony is here that I could call right now. And Sister Denise has a healing testimony. I don't know whether she can do it in 3 minutes, but somebody probably needs to say she can't do it in 3 minutes. But I really want to say, since Brother Mariko mentioned that, Tuesday night, the women are going to be focusing on submission, and they seem to really be caught up in that now. That lesson kind of worked them up. So if you did all of that, brothers better, maybe we need to agree to meet too, so we can connect and find out what they're going to be saying about us and what we can do to turn it around. So I think Tuesday night we better get ahead of the game, because they might have a whole list of stuff, number 1 through 20. And so we want to see if we can inspire the brothers. Now Monday night is prayer night, Tuesday night is the night that we're meeting, and Wednesday night is the night that we have Bible study. And we did say, I was thinking that on Tuesday, whenever we meet on Tuesday, many come on Monday night and Tuesday night, then they miss Wednesday night. Now this week is going to be consecration. And we're just going to begin our consecration. And you can come Monday night, Tuesday night, and Wednesday night, or you can just come Tuesday and Wednesday night, because we're going to pray and be teaching on consecration as well as today. It's kind of important for everybody to hear what I'm going to be sharing concerning the importance of consecration. And this consecration will be focusing on becoming more effective in carrying out the ministry of reconciliation. We really need to hear this, and we need to practice the things that we're going to be sharing. And I'm really excited about the praise team today. And boy, that was good. I guess I missed sessions like that before, but that I showed up late. I guess I did.
Pastor, no, I just wanted to say to you, our last two or three rehearsals ended up being worship.
Worship sessions. I can feel it because y'all brought it right into the praise and worship this morning. All right, so those that I didn't get today, I promise I'll give you 5 minutes. Next week would be a special Sunday, a communion, and all testimonials regarding healing and things like that would be very, very appropriate. And we're going to do that. Now, I want you to take some notes this morning, because I'm not pleased with the focus that I have seen all over, not just the north side, concerning the most important command that God has given us, which is regarding the ministry of reconciliation. I think that the believers are just too passive about it. They can take it or leave it. They don't think it's as important as them coming to church and being in prayer or being in Bible study. They don't think it's that important. And also, I think that it's important for all of us to realize how important it is for us to be taught by the fivefold ministry. You'll never get it on your own. And every session is important. Every time you have a session in the Word, Sunday school, the women's meetings on Tuesday, the men's meetings, and the Wednesday Bible studies, the Wednesday morning Bible studies, all of these things are very important, and soon we're going to be doing a new members foundational Bible study. All of these things are very, very important. So I want to encourage you to be here this week, because we're going to be really focusing on inspiring you. You know, it's important for us to talk about this, promote it, and to be thinking about how we can influence our friends, our loved ones, our neighbors, our people whose paths that we cross, how we can get them in a position where they can hear the word. It's really, really important for us to do that. And I want to just say that this week we're going to promote, we're going to pray about it, we're going to intercede, we're going to pray for the lost, we're going to pray that God will anoint you and equip you to be fervent, to be compassionate, and to really take the souls of those around you very seriously. The Bible says God does not have pleasure in the death of the wicked. He does not. And we need to go to whatever length that we need to go to rescue them from a eternity that they will forever regret and ever experience. So I'm just going to have a word of prayer. Father, we thank you in Jesus' name, the name above every name. We thank you, Lord, for this particular time in the history of this ministry, that we will go all the way back and present our lives a living sacrifice and really begin to place our lives before the Lord and ask the Lord, what will you have me to do? Whatever you require, that I will do. Whatever you say, I will say yes. Father, today we thank you for ears to hear, eyes to see, and hearts that will understand the importance of this, of the urgency of that, of winning souls. Three classes of people, Lord, you have instructed us to work with: those in the church that's doing okay. We're to encourage, we're to edify, we're to fellowship with them and do all that we can to build them up so that they will continue to live for you and to be fruitful and productive. Lord, is the other segment that don't hardly come. They spend their time doing other things and they don't know how close they are to a life of eternity alienated from you. They have no grasp because Satan blinds their eyes and he's a deceiver, comes to steal, kill, and destroy. And he's doing everything he can to pervert the way of the Lord and to get them on side issues and thinking contrary to the Word of God so that he can succeed in winning their souls and causing them to miss heaven throughout the ages to come. Father, and then there are those that have never heard, not even one time. They don't understand what the gospel is all about. They have no one, just like the Ethiopian. He was traveling from Jerusalem on his way back home. And he was reading in the book of Isaiah. And he didn't understand the work that Jesus had already done. And he was reading the passage, speaking about Jesus' death and resurrection. But he didn't understand. And it took Philip, the Lord told Philip to join himself to that chariot. And he got in that chariot and explained to him and preached to him Jesus. Oh God, that was the good news of what Jesus has done. He has become our sanctification. He has become our righteousness. He has become our wisdom. And he has become our redemption. Every person needs to understand what Jesus has done and what we have as a result of what he has done. Those are the three classes of people, Father. We give you praise and the glory, and we must have a desire to minister. Otherwise, their blood will be attributed to our hands. Father, in Jesus' name we pray. Thank you, Lord. Amen. Okay, the prerequisite, I think, for being effective in soul winning, that's what I want to touch on. The prerequisite, number one, and the text that I'm using is Deuteronomy 10, 12, and 13. The prerequisite for being effective in winning souls. In other words, just getting people to church. I'm not telling you that we got to go throughout the community, a lot of organization and accountability and all of that. I'm just telling you how we can do it the simple way, just by what inviting people. And when you invite people, they hear the word, just don't leave it at that. They need to be admonished to what? To come back and to get in a what? Bible study. Amen. I'm not getting no amens, but I mean, we can do a whole lot as believers if we were a little bit more interested, if we were a little bit more concerned. And I think that the danger we see as believers in the lives of believers, once they get what they want and get established and get well-rounded in information, then they lose the passion and the heart for what? People that don't have any of that knowledge, they lose it. And that's the reason why we need to pray, Lord, revive your work in the midst of the years. Amen. When we get comfortable, when we can take it or leave it in terms of the ministry of reconciliation, when we won't go out of our way to help people, to bless people, and spend time with them because it's going to take away from our time. Or maybe we don't feel like it after we do all that we have to do, but yet that's not an excuse. Okay, chapter 10, Deuteronomy. I'm just going to give you some things the Lord has been giving me, and I'm just going to follow through with that in each session this week. Deuteronomy 10, and now Israel, what doth the Lord thy God require of thee, but to fear the Lord thy God, to walk in all of his ways, and to love him, and to serve the Lord thy God with all thy heart and with all thy soul, to keep the commandments of the Lord and his statutes, which I command thee this day for thy good. Okay? Now, if you had to put all of that in a nutshell, I would say the two things that God is asking us to do is to obey and serve. Yeah. Obey and serve. In other words, we have to walk in all of his ways, in other words, to love him and, you know, all of that, to fear the Lord. You know, we got to do that, but that's all wrapped in obeying and what? Serving. Amen. See, everything that God is requiring us is wrapped in to obedience and what? Serving. Everybody say obey and serve.
Obey and serve.
Amen. Obey and serve is those are some broad terms. Obey means what? Loving the Lord with all your heart to the extent that you really want to please the Lord and you have a wholesome dread of displeasing God. You just don't want to fall short. And I believe that there is another scripture, you know, that is very important, a dread of displeasing the Lord, wholesome dread of displeasing the Lord, you know, that will motivate anybody to what? To obey. Yes. Study the Word, care out his, you know, his will, and do all that you can so that you won't be counted, fall short. Okay, Ecclesiastes is another scripture that I just wanted to read, and it says basically the same thing. Ecclesiastes 12:13, let us hear the conclusions of the whole matter. Fear God and keep his commandments, for this is the whole duty of man. For God shall bring every work into judgment with every secret thing, whether it be good or whether it be evil. Now in that passage, it still talks about the fear to fear God, wholesome dread of what? Displeasing God. And this is something that Jesus consistently said. He said, I always do the things that please my what? Heavenly Father. But anyway, that shows that he had a what? Fear of what? His Heavenly Father. He didn't want to please him. Displease him, rather. Okay, but another thing that Jesus also said, he said, I must work the work of him that what? Have sent me while it is what? Day, when night, before even when night cometh, what? No man. Okay, so serving the Lord is the other side of the coin. Obeying the Lord is on, you know, one side of the coin, and then serving the Lord. In other words, everything is about works almost. You know, no faith without what? Works. You know, we gotta have faith to, you know, to do it all, but works is a what? Major part of the program that God has designed for us. You gotta work. We used to sing this song, we must work until the day is done. And without works, amen, you're not going to have any grounds to stand on. People that don't do no works and that get saved, they're not going to succeed in even saving their own soul. They're the ones that's going to be what? Lost. You know, the people that try stuff and can't and don't succeed, they will be, the Bible says, they will be saved as by fire. Y'all want me to get down under here? That means that people that are what, negligent, they don't have due stuff. They don't come, they don't pay me a bit of attention. I mean, Bible study is not important to them. Prayer meetings are not something that what they're interested in. So you're gonna have, but they, you know, they try to do things for God. Amen. Without really submitting to God and letting God do things for them so that they would be more capable of performing works that will stand the test of fire. It's good to place yourself in a position where your works will stand the test of fire. And when you place yourself in a position where your works will stand the test of fire, you are building on what? The foundation of gold, silver, and what? Precious stone. But when you are half-hearted, half-committed, half-faithful, slack, and as much as I talk about Bible study and you don't show up, you know God is going to judge that. See, God is going to bring into judgment every work along with what? Every secret thing. It's all about works, practically. After you get saved, of course, there's no faith is involved, but works are not involved in the initial stage of salvation. Believing is the only thing you can do without doing anything. But you got to work. The Bible says work out. Everybody just said work out.
Work out.
Your what? Soul salvation. Work it out. Amen. With fear and trembling. This is a serious race because what happens is this. I read this to you. The time period we are experiencing now as believers is called a probation. It's called a probation. It's the time, a period of time, God will determine your fitness to serve Him throughout eternity without sin and rebellion. So if you don't do it, if you don't serve Him without sin and rebellion down here, so you rebel when we tell you to do whatever the Word says and you won't do it. Y'all want me to just preach about here alone? It's a test to see if you will what, serve God without sin and rebellion in this life. In other words, whether we will obey and serve and be counted worthy of eternal responsibilities in connection with the earth and God's kingdom. See, it's not about what happens those 20 or 30 years that you live for God down here. That's a short period of time compared to what? Eternity. My Lord, the millennium itself is 1,000 years. The Bible says we will reign with Him 1,000 years. But the Bible, in every case, I have scripture after scripture. I don't have time to get into all of that now. It says, he that overcomes. He that overcomes. Yes. Look how y'all look. Yes. It's the overcomer. Bible says we will become partakers of Christ if we hold fast our confidence, steadfast, all the way to the end. So that means that you don't have to be in Bible study, you don't have to be in prayer, and everything that we can offer you or give you here in this church, you're going to need that plus more. But God is not going to hold you accountable for things that you are not what knowledgeable or exposed to, that you haven't been what taught. But he is holding you responsible for things that we are constantly trying to admonish you to what? To receive, and you don't show up. That's the reason why I'm trying so hard, because somebody will be sadly disappointed at the judgment seat when all of your works will be what? Burned. And you'll barely escape by the skin of your teeth. All of your works you did in your flesh for self, you know, did it the way you wanted to do. And you didn't, your obedience was not the obedience that God was looking for. So God is looking for the obedience to, not to the pastor, but to the what? To the Word. The Word is going to be judging you. God pulled back, said, I'm not going to judge him. Then I'm going to defer all of the judgments, you know, people's secrets and the discern their hearts and their motives and all of that. Jesus said, well, God handed down and passed it on to Jesus, and Jesus said, I'm not going to do it either. See, Jesus was the most appropriate one to do it, because he's the one that could sympathize with us as human beings, because he has gone through every what thing that we have ever experienced. I mean, he lived here, right? And he was what? He was in all points tempted as we are, but the Bible says yet without sin. So he's in the best position to sympathize with us, because at the judgment seat of Christ, he will be able to identify with things that we had struggles with, our weaknesses or our inabilities. He will be able to what? To relate to that. But Jesus pulled back and said, I don't want to do it either. He said, I'm going to even pass it on to the Word. How many believe the Word has eyes? It can discern, it can see, it follows you, every secret thing you do. The Word is what? The Word is what? Is a person. Amen. So Jesus said, the words that I speak, they're not my words. They're what? My Father. So God is still the judge. Jesus is still the judge, but what? It's not on the basis of what? Who they are. It's the basis on what? The Word. That's the reason why obedience is so important. Amen. Obedience. I mean, obey and what? Serve. Everybody say obey. So you gotta do something. You gotta what? Do something. And you need to know, the Bible says, don't be unwise, but understand what the will of the Lord is. Don't be a fool. Yeah. Amen. You expected all these rewards and blessings and all these things, amen, to be handed out to you, and you haven't even talked to your neighbor or whoever God places across, you know, puts in your path. Well, there's a lot of people that you can what? Influence of the kingdom of God. You don't have to what? Go all over the country. You don't have to go to Africa and Australia and all over the world. Just what? Deal with those what? That surround you. Sister Denise dealt with one of Brother Sonny's friends' wife. He passed away. But last Sunday she was here. Yes. And we're going to work on that, sister. At least we're going to work on what? Getting her into what church? If she's not in Bible study. Amen. Well, I guess I could shut down here, but I don't want to. But I want to give you three scriptures, because many of us feel that if we are respectful, if we have a good name, if we don't do anything that we know is wrong, and if we don't go to the club and what else? And chase women and catch them. And drink and do drugs and curse people out. Then we say, I'm on my way to heaven and I'm so glad. I'm on my way to heaven and I'm so glad. I'm on my way to heaven and I'm so glad. The devil can't do me no harm. But I want you to understand that the other side of the coin is that omission. You got to serve God. I know I got that right. I know I got it right. I'm going to just kind of bounce around a little bit, but I'm just going to break it down in those day sessions and Wednesday night. I'm just going to break it down. In Revelation 2, I got a lot of scriptures that says over and over, the believer has to be an overcomer. And even in Revelation it says, because you are lukewarm, you're neither cold nor hot. See, it was predicted that the church age where we find ourselves in will be the age, a church age that will what? Serve God out of what? Out of what? Out of, you know, what? Out of tradition. They just go through the motion. They really won't have it at heart. And the author said they are neither what? Cold or hot. We'll turn back to that. Okay, Revelation 2:26, it says that, and he that overcometh and keepeth my works, W-O-R-K-S. See, how many know that we are God's workmanship, created unto good works, that we should walk in them? See, there's a path. Everybody just watching me, there's a path. Okay, and the Bible says the works that God has designed for us to walk in or to do are the works that will be transpiring throughout your life. And suppose you ignore all of that.
All right.
And you just don't what? Go the path that God has already mapped out to you. You just want to serve yourself. Please your flesh. Easy, the easier the better. Somebody said that that if you follow the least, if you follow the path of least, following the path of least resistance is the thing that makes what? Everything crooked. Make you crooked too. That's what rivers do. They follow the what? Path of what? That's the reason why they wind around. They try to follow the path of what? Least resistance. And so here's the thing that I'm going to try to get over to you. See, unless you are willing to suffer for the sake of Christ, you really don't have the spirit of Christ.
All
right. Jesus didn't down here for 33 years. He wasn't here to please himself.
Come on.
Is that right?
That's right.
The Bible says that man, what? He endured what? All types of what? Contradiction against from sinners. In other words, opposition from sinners. I mean, he faced what? The shame of the cross. I mean, that wasn't pleasant. 13 assassination attempts. Everybody that didn't understand what he came for was against him. And the Bible says if Jesus had to suffer, amen, we are called, the Bible says that we, the believers, we are called, just like Jesus, what? To suffer. Not only just to believe on it, but somebody says, oh, I like the good part. We're not just called just to believe on it
and enjoy his presence, and amen, praise God, and pray in tongues, and dance all over the church. But the Bible says also we are called, what? To suffer, just like he suffered. And the Bible says we are not above our master, neither the servant above the Lord, their Lord. And the Bible says the strong, they that are strong, ought to what? Bear.
Yes.
Y'all don't hear me here.
Yes.
Bear the what? Infirmities of the what? Weak.
Yes, Lord.
And not please themselves.
Come on.
It's not about pleasing yourself. Amen. Because I mean, it was Wednesday, we had a session, and Brother Walter and Sister Christians were here. And we were down praying for about 30 minutes, and you know, I know that's kind of long for that's old time praying that long, you know. So when I got up after 30 minutes, I saw them in the seats, and I didn't even feel Sister Wayne had been here from, you know, earlier. I mean, from 10, I didn't feel like that was one morning. I said, man, I got so much to do. Oh, I was, you know, getting ready to do some things Thursday that I had to have in place. But I didn't feel like coming. In fact, I wanted to get my walk, you know, my 30 or 45 minutes of walking. And I wanted some breakfast. But I said, if I got my breakfast, got my walk, and there ain't all these errands, then I wouldn't be able to make it. And I said, I would take, amen, I would take these 10 o'clock Bible study over all of that. So sometimes, Scripture says, if any man comes after me, let him what? First deny himself, take up his cross, and what? Follow me. He that seeketh to save his life shall what? Lose it. How many want to lose your life? It's going to be real hard. That's the reason why I'm going to just outline this with to you. All of the things, the reasons why we got to be concerned about people, because there are a whole string of things that the Bible says awaits the believer throughout eternity that we haven't even considered. The Bible says people that commit sins, and there's a whole there's a lot of different categories. Sins of immorality. That's sins of what? Adultery and fornication, perversion. And there are sins that deal with what? Having an attitude.
That's right.
There's a whole bunch of those sins, right? There's sins of intemperance, no self-restraint. And there are sins of what? Irreverence, not putting God first and not fearing the Lord like you should. Put everything before the Lord. All of these are categories, and the categories weren't mentioned were described as sins which are such like. Watch this. They that do these things,
yes, Lord,
shall not inherit the kingdom of God. See, the kingdom of God is not meat and drink.
Right.
It's not having fun and getting on a picnic and showing up on Sunday. It's not meat and drink. It's what? Righteousness?
Amen.
Peace?
Yes.
Joy? What? In the Holy Ghost.
Yes, Lord.
So there are some things that you got to do. The Bible says, he that keepeth these works. Works?
Yes.
What works? Well, suffering and endurance, denying the flesh, all of these are things that we got to what do in order to be more effectual, in order to have works that will be built on what? Gold, silver, and what? Precious stuff. You got to suffer. If you suffer, you reign with it.
Yes, Lord.
How many believe that?
Amen.
They are works. How many can say amen? They are works. Because we were called. The Bible says that we have been bought with a price.
We've been bought with, everybody said, bought with a price.
Bought with a price.
And the primary reason why Christ bought us, he made us, and if he had to what? Buy us back. And it was a great price, the price of his blood.
Yes.
He paid the price.
Yes, but he did.
He was willing to do it because he knew the joy that what? That was set before him.
Yes.
He knew that it would bring millions and millions of sons and daughters into the kingdom. He prized those souls that his sacrifice and his death would what? Enable to come into the kingdom. He didn't try to please himself. Now, that shows you that there's a price that what has to be paid. There's a race that has to be won. And Christ has already what? Made it possible. Yes. We are that what? Workmanship. Created into Christ for our good works. Because he has what? Called us before the foundation of the world to be what? Holy and without blame. How many can say amen?
Amen.
And the only way we can do that is what? Through his grace. I mean, we can please God. See, amazing grace got us into the kingdom by faith, not by works. Right? Amazing grace. That was the first work of what? God, in terms of what? Delivering us from the power of darkness and translating us into the kingdom. That's the work of grace.
Amen.
Saving. How many thank God for saving grace?
Yes, hallelujah. Thank you.
Hallelujah. But there's more than what? Saving grace that God, the Bible says, through the abundance of grace.
Yes.
Woo! And the gift of righteousness. We what? Reign. We rule. So God has standing grace. He has what? Sanctifying grace. Overcoming grace. How many believe that?
Yes.
That's the reason why the grace of God that brings salvation has appeared. Woo! It's here. Hey, how many thank God for the grace of God? Somebody said, grace is God doing for you what you never would have been able to do for yourself. God's unmerited favor, the sum total of all that God has done for us through Christ. And now he's doing it now through the Holy Ghost.
Yes, hallelujah.
The Holy Ghost is what? It's in us.
Yes.
Hallelujah.
How many know Christ is in us?
Yes.
How many know he's in us?
Yes.
Christ in us. In you.
Yes.
The what? Holy Glory. So we got what? Overcoming grace.
Yes.
Amen. And that's what you have to have in order what? To please God.
Amen.
So you have to what? Learn how to submit.
Come on.
Learn how to what? Humble yourself.
Yes.
Push back the plate.
Come on.
Push back the plate.
All right.
Y'all don't hear me.
All right.
Some of y'all new people probably don't know what we're talking about when we said push back the plate. That means what?
Stop eating for a time. Miss your breakfast.
Come on.
Miss your son of tea at dinner.
This church, we go 3 days.
Amen.
Amen.
Is that right? Sometime. I mean, I guess it's history now. Way back then, but we try to what? Revive the work in the midst of the years. Because sometime in the midst of the years, we stop fasting and start eating fast.
Come on.
We stop what? Praying and start playing. Playing church. How many know there's got to be some suffering in this thing? How many know that we have to what? Deny flesh, bring the flesh, subdue the flesh, mortify the deeds of the body, put flesh, amen. If the Bible says they that are in the flesh cannot what? Please God.
Amen.
See, here's the problem is that we're going to be judged on your willingness to suffer and how well you are able to what? Control your flesh.
Amen.
You're going to be judged on that. You're running a race. And God knows you got to what? You got to be disciplined in order what? To finish your race.
Right.
Paul said, I fought a good fight. I kept the faith.
Amen.
Before, Paul was always
always talking about what? Keeping under his body. I can't let my body run the show. I can't just what? Minister when I feel like I want to.
Come on.
He said, amen. A portion of the gospel has been what? Committed to me. I got a race to run. There's a path. But I gotta what? I gotta fulfill. I gotta try. I gotta do what God has what called me to do. Now, I'm just about to go through scriptures. That's all I'm gonna do. Alright, John 4:17. He that knoweth, see, it's not about being good and sweet and nice and don't harm us. Most of y'all are just really, all y'all good people. Everybody here, that is nice for all of y'all. Anybody would let you come over your house and eat.
That's right.
Hey, but I guess what, except when you have real people. I'm just kidding. But we make it in terms of our lifestyle. I don't know anybody that hates the pastor. Talk about the pastor behind his back.
That's
right. Cross us a year. Nobody ever said that. Everybody likes us a year. People ain't giving us stuff like that. Now, people, John 4:17. He said, He that knoweth to do good. All right. That's where these scriptures trip us out. Because what? There are saints that don't show up already. Nobody mess with them. We just say, well, they can come just like me. But the Bible says, all of what? They have the infirmities of the weak and not please themselves. But every man please his neighbor to the good of their what? Edification. I know that scripture. Okay? 1 John 4:17. Is that right?
Amen.
I got it wrong?
No.
He that what? James 4:17. Okay, he that knows to do good and to do it is not what is said. These things just come to me as I talk, so therefore I don't always have a handle on them. But Sister Denise, the scripture which says that withhold not good from them to whom it is good. When it's in the power of your hand to do it. Now these teachings and things like that will never register with you until you actually what? Begin to what? Submit yourself to the Lord. You gotta what? Get into a certain realm where any of the word of God will become what? Meaningful. In other words, you're more respected. You just let it pass all over. You'll never think about it again. Oh Lord.
All right.
How many want me to sit down? I am. Man alive.
My.
All right. That's that first scripture. I'm gonna get my transcript here and then I'll know for sure. I could just read all this
stuff I have written here. And I don't like to read stuff to you. Good. James 4:17, therefore to him who knows to do good and does it not. To him it is what?
Sin.
All right, that's the first scripture. And the other scripture is Proverbs 3:27. Withhold not good from them to whom it is due when it is in the power of thine hand to do it. Okay, so that's what's said of what? Omission.
Mm-hmm.
All right, now if you don't do nothing at all and call yourself saved,
all right,
then you're going to be what? That person that God distributed that talent to, that what? Brought the thing back in the same shape that he gave it to. He didn't do anything at all. A faith that does not result in activity of any kind is a dead faith, because the Bible says faith without what? Works is dead.
It's
dead. See, a lot of times people don't do nothing for the Lord. It is empty, worthless, insincere. Not only does it fail to produce any works of service that can be rewarded, In other words, it will not produce a person that's inactive, that don't do anything. They fail to produce any kind of work that God can what? Reward.
Amen.
And that person, amen, they fail to secure the salvation of their own soul. You know, because one of those servants was thrown into outer darkness. That's the person that had no words. They're the one that was lost. Y'all didn't hear that. They're the one that was what? Lost. And Jesus even said that, amen, if you're neither cold nor hot, then I will what? Spew you out of my mouth. It doesn't sound like that person was saved to me.
That's right.
The Bible says, the person that holds fast their confidence all the way to the end.
Yes.
Amen. Those are the ones that's going to what? Amen. He that endure to the end, the same shall be saved.
Yes. Hallelujah.
The last scripture I'm going to read is Malachi 4:18. Then ye shall, I said preach scripture. I gave you James 4:17. I've given you what? Proverbs 3:27. Mm-hmm. And now I'm giving you Malachi 3:18. Then ye shall again discern between the righteous and the wicked, between one who serves God and one who does not serve God. In other words, if you really want to discern the difference between the righteous and the wicked, it goes back to that scripture. It's the one that what? Serves God. The righteous is the one that what? I mean, these are the people that will what? Do the works. People in the church need works from you. We're going to be judged on that. People in the church need to be encouraged.
Yes.
People outside of the church need to be what? Admonished to what? Be faithful and consistent. Amen. Praise God. All right. So, how many got it? Got to obey. Got to live a good life. How many can say? The grace of God will help you do that, right? If you do what the Lord says, right? But you got to do more than what? Live good and have a life.
All right.
People are going to be saved just by your life.
Come on.
It will help. They won't be saved for sure if you don't have one.
Come on.
A good one.
Right.
That's right.
Right? But you got to what? Speak to the
sinner to save his life.
Yes.
That right?
Yes.
You got to what? More? Open them up. Tell him what's awaiting him.
Yes.
Amen. Praise God. In eternity, if he doesn't turn to God.
Come on.
Yeah. Tell him that Satan is the God of this world.
Yes.
And he comes to what? Blind folk.
Yes.
To keep them from understanding what? The gospel.
Come on.
Tell him the devil comes to what? Steal, kill, and destroy. But Jesus comes that he might have what?
Yes.
Share the love of God with him. Amen. All right. Well, I'm done. Scripture says, be faithful unto death.
Yes.
And I will give you a what? Crown of life.
My.
Amen. It's about obeying.
Right.
I'm going to say amen.
Amen.
It's about obeying your pastor.
Oh, yes.
Don't be ignored. I don't even need to be here if you're not going to do anything I say. I might as well what? Pack up and what? Move on down the road. Somebody will want me. Somebody say that. Praise God. Amen. Come to Christ. If you're not happy with Christ, the devil will always take you back. Amen. Praise God. So I can go down the road. Somebody will what? Somebody will want me. Somebody will want me to tell them the truth. Amen. Because you're going to face it all when what? You stand in judgment. You're going to face it all. Amen. Praise God. So I want you to be in the best shape that you possibly could be in when you stand before the Lord. And for that reason, I'm going to be admonishing you. Amen. Now those 12:25. But I want every person, I want you to be anointed today for this consecration. And we're just going to tell you to fast this week. Not eat fast. And we're going to ask you to abstain from maybe we can do a Daniel's fast. Next week we'll get more serious. Everybody want a Daniel's fast here? Just do fruits and vegetables.
Amen. No meats, no sweets, no, other than the fruits and whatever. No serious foods. And all of this mayonnaise and dressing and cheese and all of that. They just eat plain stuff. Everybody wants to eat plain stuff. Raw. Amen. So if you don't want to do that, just go with juice. Juice is not that good unless you do it yourself. Fresh fruits are best for you because that's real food that will fill your body up. Juices that's been pasteurized, it's very acidic, it's not good. So you can go with condensed water, that would be good. Because it has energy in it. You can drink that and get energy. Okay, so that's what we're going to be doing this week. And this is going to prepare you for a clear fast, a complete fast on next week. On the week after, before Thanksgiving and Christmas for sure.
Amen.
So before y'all start making pies and cakes and ducks and all that, amen. Tell everybody that really want to be in the best possible condition in order to be effective in the ministry of reconciliation. I'm going to hold everybody accountable for getting somebody here in the month of November. Amen. Somebody have already got your people in place. You're in good shape. But we want every person, if you can influence somebody to come, otherwise, what do we need to say about that? Think about something. Amen. Everybody standing. And I'm going to really, really ask you personally, in some instances, when you pray, can you do what we need? Oh, we thank you for strength. Thank you, Lord, that we can thank you for salad, raw food, fresh vegetables and fruit, and get away from the things that